it's a good step, really, that Uganda as a country has worked on its INDC. And we hope that maybe it will be a catalyst for leveraging financing. Country actions should be able to reduce 20% of the emissions within the country. We may be emitting maybe 0 point something, but 20% of that by 2030. As much as the INDC is focusing on mitigation, but Uganda has clearly brought it out that for us, the main priority is adaptation. Focusing on different sectors like agriculture, like water, livestock and others. There are also cross-cutting issues that the government has put into consideration. One of them is the gender perspectives, making sure that women's views are heard in decision-making. The funding that is available now in the country is focusing on mitigation. There's no funding for adaptation. And yet there's a lot of needs for adaptation. We cannot do mitigation alone without addressing adaptation issues. If we are talking about mitigation and we have not put incentives in place, it is not going to work. So that's why we think that the mix of adaptation and mitigation, a 50-50 mix, would create more impact than focusing on mitigation alone. We have a problem of short-term financing. We get problems, projects, but it works for 1 year and it's over. And adaptation cannot happen in a year or two. It is a process. So we need to focus on long-term programming for us to be able to achieve what we are committing to do. The CSO meetings that have been happening in the country, the pre-COP meetings, one of the emphasis has been on supporting climate-smart agriculture, because we know that over 85% of our population depends on agriculture for their income and survival. So CSOs are calling upon the government and the COP decisions to support climate-smart agriculture, focusing on early warning systems, weather information, preparedness for disasters, because there are a lot of losses that happen. As a country, we don't have a loss and damage mechanism in place to be able to offset the losses. We don't have that. But already the figures show that it's a big problem and it should be a priority for us. But the challenge is that we don't have frameworks in place, we don't have the financing for it. We also need to have prepare people really to manage the losses, because if you're going to put an insurance scheme in place for loss and damage, people are not using weather information to be able to know I should plant at this time, or there's a flood coming, so I should move out of the flood prone area to another place. There are prerequisites for loss and damage to work, and if we don't prepare for that, then you'll fail to manage it, because everybody will incur losses and everybody will expect to be compensated. We have somehow not looked at the role of private sector in climate change adaptation and mitigation. Even nationally, in the meetings that we do, in the different forums, you rarely see private sector participating. And yet climate change is impacting them as well. And sometimes they even have the resources to contribute to that. We need capacity building for local governments, because that's where the issues are actually happening. We may be here in Kampala, but everything is happening down there, and the local governments are on the front line of managing that. So the financing should trickle down from global to regional to national, and finally to the local levels, the local governments and communities.